Welcome. What we got here is another exciting episode of Amelia's Weekly Fish Fry, brought to you by eejournal.com. I'm Amelia Dalton, and this week we're talking about not one, but two of my favorite subjects, robots and music. I know, what could be better, right? Now, without further ado, let's get into some serious robot business. And not just plain old robots. Oh no. We're talking about robots that you, yes you, can create yourself. And that can work with your Raspberry Pi. Oh yeah. Now, what the heck am I talking about? The GertBOT? Yes, what is the GertBOT robotics add-on board all about? What cool things can you do with it? And what's really under the hood? Well, let me bring in Sagar Jethani from Element14 to talk about all of this and more. And the music part I mentioned earlier, we'll get into that as well. Check it out. Hi, Sagar. Thank you so much for joining me.
Hi, Amelia. Thanks for having me.
So a while back, I had the pleasure of interviewing Gert Van Loo, the creator of the Gert board. And I just saw that Element 14 has rolled out a new Raspberry Pi expansion board called the GertBOT. Now, Sagar, what is this board all about?
So the GertBOT is an expansion board for the Raspberry Pi, and it adds a tremendous amount of motor control to the Raspberry Pi. We realized that a lot of Pi users were into robotics and were creating robotics applications for the Raspberry Pi. And as powerful as the Pi is, the users were coming up against its inherent limitations. What the GertBOT does is it massively expands those capabilities. It has four full H bridges that can control either four brushed motors or two stepper motors. And as we'll talk about later, you can even cascade up to four different GertBOTs onto a single Pi to massively increase the number of brushed and stepper motors you're using. In addition to the motor control, however, the GertBOT also is a power management board. It has enough RGB channels for you to control up to 30,000 LEDs, or as I call it, an entire office park or an entire massive building. And it can even generate digital command control signals, the kinds used to control model trains, for instance. So you could conceivably control a model train set directly from the GertBOT with the Raspberry Pi. Probably the coolest thing about the GertBOT is that it does all of this by virtue of having its own processor. It has an ARM Cortex M3, and coupled with the user interface that comes with the GertBOT, that means the Raspberry Pi can effectively outsource its motor control functions to the GertBOT, leaving the Pi's own BCM processor free to do other things.
Now, Sagar, real quick, will the GertBOT work with my Raspberry Pi Model A and Model B?
Yeah, we are happy to announce that it is fully compatible with the Model A, the Model B, the Model B Plus, and the Raspberry Pi 2.
Excellent. So let's get into the motor control part of this. What can be controlled by the GertBOT, and what kind of applications could you create with this bad boy?
The GertBOT has four full H bridges. So what that means is that one GertBOT can control four brushed motors or two stepper motors. There are a couple other tricks that the GertBOT offers. It has enough RGB channels for you to operate up to 30,000 LEDs. It also, for any of your listeners who may be model train enthusiasts, it can generate DCC, or digital command control signals, which allows you to control model train engines. So you could control a model train's motions by scripting these on the Raspberry Pi. What's also very cool about the GertBOT is that you can cascade up to four of them. So if those previous numbers I shared with you about four brushed motors and two stepper motors aren't enough, you can increase that to up to 16 brushed motors or eight stepper motors by cascading four different GertBOTs to a single Raspberry Pi.
Wow, that's cool. Okay, Sagar, how much is the GertBOT, and is it shipping today?
The GertBOT is shipping today, and it's available on Newark Element 14 for $64.40. It's a very cool product that massively increases the capabilities of a Raspberry Pi.
All right, so if my audience wants more information about the GertBOT, where should they go?
Element14.com. If you go to Element14 and click into our Raspberry Pi group, you'll see all of our accessories, including the GertBOT. And you might discover a couple other things we offer which expand the functionality of your Raspberry Pi in even more ways.
Very cool. So, Sagar, it's time for your off-the-cuff question. Now, I know that you're a guitar teacher. Is that correct?
I do a little bit on the side, yes.
Okay. And so you were just telling me that you were thinking about buying a guitar this weekend. So what are you looking at buying?
So I've been playing guitar for a very long time. And for most of that time, I've used the same guitar that I purchased when I was 16 years old, my trusty Ibanez Saber. But I'm thinking of getting a Fender Strat today, just kind of taking it back old school. It's such an iconic instrument. I figure, how can I go wrong? And plus, the Ibanez I used to play, it's more associated with the glory days of hair metal, which, as anybody who has met me will tell you, I'm a little bit beyond now.
That's awesome. Okay, so as a side question, I've met quite a few engineers or people in high tech that are involved in music, but the most of them are guitar players in particular. Now, what do you think about that? What do you think about the intersection between guitar playing and engineering or high tech?
You know, that's a really fascinating question. I actually have a thought on that. A guitar is a very unique instrument, I think, especially in the West. Unlike a piano, which is probably the next most popular instrument, you know, on a piano you sit down and you play a note and it's ready-made. It doesn't change unless your piano is out of tune. With a guitar, the note only is produced if you make it happen. You're controlling the pitch and the velocity of the attack. And there is a strong tradition of guitarists modding and hacking their guitars. I was just watching a documentary on Smithsonian.com. They honored the guitarist Eddie Van Halen a couple of months ago, and they called him the Thomas Edison of guitar because besides his amazing playing technique, he also ruthlessly experimented with his guitar as a teenager trying to make it sound better. So, for example, to eliminate electrical noise from his guitar pickups, which are the electromagnets that capture the signal and amplify it, he noticed that the wires seemed a bit loose, so he experimented by dipping them in melted wax and encasing them. That's now a standard production technique by virtually every pickup manufacturer in the world. He also would take necks and bodies, spare parts from the local guitar stores, and combine them in ways that you weren't supposed to combine them because he wanted to get a different kind of sound that he could hear in his head. So I think that DIY electronics, making, engineering, and electric guitar playing in particular have a very special history.
I think you're right. I think you touched on a really important element of guitar playing and maybe the intersection with high tech and engineering. Well, thank you so much for joining me, Sagar. It's always a pleasure speaking with you.
Likewise, Amelia. Thanks so much for having me.
What do you think? Do you think there are more musicians and guitar players, especially in the world of engineering, than in other fields? I'm kind of thinking yes, but let me know what you think in the box below the player on this week's fish frying page on eejournal.com, or even on our EE Journal Facebook page. And hey, if you want to check out that interview with Eddie Van Halen that Sagar mentioned, I've included a link below the player on this week's fish frying page as well. And let's keep this musical train a-running, because it's time for a little news you may have missed. Mixtape edition. Now, folks, let me see some hands. How many of you, at some point in the past, most likely, made or received some kind of mixtape? And no, I am not talking about a CD. I'm talking about the old school cassette tape style. Maybe some of you even recorded it from the radio. Mm-hmm. Carefully. Ah, shoot. When is that song gonna play again? Dang it. And yes, I am part of that tribe. I believe the first mixtape that I received from a long ago boyfriend included a Pantera song, Metallica tune or two, and even the seminal Silent Lucidity by Queensryche. Oh, yes. So, What if you're wanting to put together a mixtape for a friend, or a road trip perhaps, or to woo that lady or guy, as the case may be? Put together a CD? Probably not. It's just not the same, right? Let me bring in the USB mixtape. Now, Sydney, Australia product designer Tiffany Rodas, who in her Etsy store is now selling USB mixtape. Not only can you share your favorite tunes, but also photos and videos, which may or may not be a good idea. It's the possibly a judgment call there, but it includes 8 gigabytes of storage in a perfectly classic retro style that does resemble those mixtapes that you loved so well so long ago. Now, the price point is a bit higher than the mixtapes of the past. This one will cost you about $45. But then again, if you play it over and over and over and over, it won't start sounding funny. So there's that. If you want to check out this next generation of mixtape, I would encourage you to click the link below the player on this week's fish frying page on eejournal.com. Hey, have you checked out EE Journal on social media yet? Well, you should. You can find us at facebook.com/eejournal. If you're into Twitter, you can monitor our tweets at EEJournalTFM. And hey, if Google Plus is your thing, you can also join our circle there as well. We also have a YouTube channel, keyword, EEJournal, chock full of all kinds of techie videos, our very own Chalk Talk webcast series, and our video series called On the Scene. And you can subscribe to our EE Journal YouTube channel as well. I'm just saying. Also, by clicking the links below the player on this week's Fish Fryin' page, you can also grab our Fish Fryin' RSS feed or subscribe to Fish Fry via the iTunes Store. And remember, if you want any further information about the stories covered in today's show, head on over to eejournal.com and look for this week's Fish Frying page. Thank you everyone for tuning in. If you know of any cool new technology, any fun EE conference coming up that I absolutely should attend, or perhaps the best geeky hotspot in your city, shoot me a line at amelia@eejournal.com. Or post a comment on our forums on EE Journal. For the week of April 17th, 2015, I'm Amelia Dalton, and you've been fried.